بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليلا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم إني أسألك علما نافعا ورزقا طيبا وعملا متقبلا آمين يا رب العالمين Before I will start the presentation, there are three requests I have so that we can really benefit from the presentation today. The first request is that every slide is about me, that I should focus myself, that the lesson in any nasiha, in any presentation is for me. I will not judge other people, you know, on this presentation. Rather, I will focus on myself. Number second request I have, my brothers and my sisters, try to see the bigger picture of everything I will say. Even if I am talking about children, that has a bigger picture. The same rule we can apply when it comes to husband and wife. Same rule we can apply when it comes to our relationship with extended family. Same rule we can apply most of the time when we are dealing with extended community. So this is the second request I have. The third request I have, everything we come across in this dunya is a question for you and me that we have to answer one day in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, nothing happens in this dunya randomly. Everything is well planned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you come across any friend, or if you happen to have, you know, husband of some and wife of some, or children, father of some, that is not random. All these are questions. Your wife is questioned for you. Your husband is questioned for you. Your children, your maal, your job, your friends. So remember, when we talk about things in this presentation, these are questions of life that we deal with. Today, my job is to inspire you to think out of box. You know, one of the major problems we face as a ummah, that we have very tunnel vision. We don't see the bigger picture. We just go on the literal meaning of things, and we don't want to think right and left. The first message that we learn from the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is that always see the bigger picture. Find out the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded you something. Why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did what he did? There got to be a reason. So once you understand the bottom line spirit, the ruh of the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the practice of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it opens up so many windows and so many options for you and me that we can follow and we can practice. For example, if I tell you that we have to reach Houston, and if you have very tunnel vision, you will say that I will go Houston by taking I-10. But if you understand the meaning of the command that I have to reach Houston, I can go I-10, I can take 90, I can take plane, I can take, you know, ferry from Vini. There are so many different ways that I can reach to Houston. The goal was to reach to Houston. The same way, whenever we listen to any command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it always have a bigger picture in front of you. So one thing which I will do in today's presentation to inspire you to think out of box. And the second thing which will happen because of that is to broaden, you know, our horizon. When I say happy family, if you read the definition of family, family means husband and wife. But wallahi, when you live in a country, when you are minority, the definition of family is way bigger than just husband and wife. That's why, as I said in my Friday little, you know, talk today, that it has four components. If you want family to be happy family, then you have to make sure that we take care of all four components. Husband and wife, I consider one component. The second component is our children. The third component is our extended family. Most of the time we ignore, after marriage we think that it is all just about husband and wife. Yes, it starts from husband and wife, because that is the basic pillar of the family. If this pillar will be stable and strong, then rest of the structure, rest of the building, rest of the family will be strong and in peace and on the same page. Agree on this, that husband and wife is the most important pillar of this whole equation. Fourth one is our community. A lot of time I have seen brothers, they live in isolation. They feel like that if I'm making good money, I have good business, and you know, my family, my children are happy, you know, I'm going in the right direction. Wallahi, I can tell you one thing, and I want to mention it right now so I will not forget down the road. Your community is your new family. Where you live, that is your new family. The family back home, you have left that family. So this community will be your family. And I will not just confine to a little town. I will say whoever lives, you know, around you, could be Houston, could be the same country. This whole United States is your family. Because, you know why I'm saying is that? Because if you confine yourself to just you and your children, down the road, I see big problem. And that problem is when you want to marry your kids. If you are social in community and you take part in the community, you know, events, and you are big role model in the community, that you are everywhere in the community, wallahi, you have bright future in the community down the road. But if you confine yourself and your family just to you and your kids, you have taken the wrong path. That's why intentionally I have included, you know, community when you want happy family. And remember one thing, and I have mentioned this in one of my Friday khutbah, there was the biggest study done by Harvard University, the biggest and the oldest. It's been 100 years, last 100 years they are doing this study. And this is an ongoing study. What is happiness and how you achieve happiness? And the final result of that study is that you can only be happy when your family is happy. Happiness doesn't come with money. It doesn't come with how many friends you have. But if your family is happy, that will bring you the true happiness. We all know the best example for us to follow our role model is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. From every aspect, you know the ayah I read in front of you, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that we have completed this deen and this ni'mah, wa raditu lakum al-islama deena, and we have chosen Islam for you. When deen is complete, the one who has brought this deen, his life is also complete. The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected this Quran, the ayahs of Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like he has not protected the life of any of the prophets before him. And the reason was, the hidayah comes only now from Quran, and the only role model for you and me is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I will share with you, to give you a bigger picture, saying of Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, which I have shared before, just for new brothers and to remind everybody. He says in one of the saying, Hazrat Ali, that don't raise your kids the way you were raised, because they are born for different time. They have different challenges. They have different requirements to make them function according to their potential, raise them according to the needs of their time. And this rule you can expand, as I said in the beginning, on all aspects of our life. The second thing which I will share with you, the famous saying of Hazrat Amr bin Al-As, Raziyallahu ta'ala anhu, and he gives a bigger picture that life is not just about marrying, life is not just about raising few kids, life is not just about making few dollars, life has a bigger picture. There is a purpose in life. That's why Sayyid Qutb Shahid Rahmatullah Alayh said, the people who don't understand the purpose of life, even they have lived 60 years, 70 years, 90 years, they are the biggest loser of this life. So Hazrat Amr bin Al-As, one day he enters in his home and he sees his wife feeding his child. And he addresses to his wife, saying that don't feed this child like you are just feeding, you know, any child. Rather, have the understanding that you are helping one abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to help him grow. So one day when he will be a grown man or woman, he will serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will do ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will fulfill the requirement of abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So whatever he or she will do in his life or her life, that will become sadqa-e jariya for you. So he had given bigger picture to his wife. And this is just an introduction that I wanted to share with you. Handle your family with love, not with brain. You know, when you work at your job place, you use your brain, your intellect, your mind. But if you will try to handle your family with your brain and mind, you will be the loser. Family should be handled out of love, mercy, courtesy, providing space, giving them room. And inshallah, as I will go, I will explain this more. The very prerequisite of happy family is a stable family. A stable family means that everybody is on the same page. 95% of our family problems, 95%, I'm not exaggerating, is because of unstable family. That family, husband and wife, they have issues. Or issues between husband and wife and extended family. From the wife side family issues or husband side family's issues. This is the first requirement, my brothers and my sisters, and I will give you more, you know, tips how we can keep our family stable. But keep this concept in mind. A stable family is the first prerequisite. I have seen broken families, and then I have seen the effect of that on your kids. When we live in this country, our mindset is also like the mindset of any other person living in this country. That you marry, you enjoy life, you don't like, you just say bye, my way or highway. No tolerance, no room for each other, no, you know, struggle to understand each other, no effort to understand each other. Rather, if you don't understand me, maybe we have different personality. So I think it's better for us to separate. You go your way, I go my way. No. Really, this is not the way of a Muslim mindset. Muslim mindset is that once I'm marrying, yes, there will be issues. This is a constant. Marriage is not a piece of cake. Marriage is something which is constant struggle. Every day I have to move on step by step. It takes time. It needs effort. And for that, I will do my best. So I will not exit. This relationship should stay, because this is what, I'm not talking about exceptions. There are exceptions. But in general, what I see when it goes to separation or divorce in among our Muslim families, most of the time I have seen reason which was fixable, easily fixable. But because we are in rush, we have no tolerance for each other. We want result right now. We want to see a girl who has come in my home, perfect wife from tomorrow. Not even tomorrow, from today. And I want perfect husband from today. And remember one thing, life is not perfect. Life is perfect, whatever humanly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has considered it should be. Life is perfect in Jannah. Here, nobody, even the king of the country, cannot say that my glass is full. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed this dunya in such a way, even for king, 20% of his glass is empty. So nobody can say that my glass is 100% full. So life will have issues. It's that how you handle. That's why the famous, you know, phrase I say, life is about option and choices. And life is always about adjustment. Did you adjust, you know, according to the time and the need? This is a rule. I know most of you cannot see the slide. It's very small. But what goes around comes around. How you live your life today, how you behave with people today, how you take care of your elders today, your parents, your in-laws, your grandparents, wallahi, same thing is going to haunt you tomorrow. This is a rule of this dunya. This is a rule. If you are nice with people today, you will see many people will come around, they will be nice to you. So what goes around comes around. Life is not perfect. Everything is not fixable. Everything in life is not fixable. You have to adjust. One of the major things which I have seen among families, and this applies to husband and wife or in our extended family or among children as well. Assumption that whatever I am thinking or whatever information I have or whatever I know, whatever is in my consideration, the party in front of me, they already know it. And I assume it. That's a wrong assumption most of the time. Explain, brothers, communicate. Tell the other person in front of you what your plan is, what you want, and why you want that. Why you are doing this. Don't keep other party in dark. Communicate whatever you are thinking. Most of the time, you know, we don't communicate and we just assume that other party will understand. You know, I'm not saying they are asking me something and I'm not saying no or yes. They will understand. What does it mean? They may not understand. You have to speak up. You have to say what you are thinking and what you have in your mind and your heart. Parenting is a skill. And I will, as I said in the beginning, not just parenting. Wallahi, everything in life is a skill. Being wife is a skill now. Being husband is a skill now that we have to learn how to be a good husband, how to be a good wife. Unfortunately, we don't teach that to our kids. We teach them how to be a good doctor, how to be a good businessman. But how many of us, we teach our daughters that how you should be a good wife and good daughter-in-law? And same way, how many of us, we teach our sons that how you should be a good husband and good son-in-law? Wallahi, this is something that we need to teach our kids, because the issues I see is because they have no clue. They get married. You know, even if you go for a barber license to cut somebody's hair, you need license. You know, as a doctor, I say, you know, we should start giving license for marriages as well. That you should go through some counseling, some sessions to understand what you are getting into. You have no clue, you get married and next day you want everything perfect. And that is the issue. And that's why most of the communities in America, they have started sessions with future husband and wife so they can understand what they are getting in. One thing called relaxed parenting. Relaxed parenting is basically, if you know your destiny, you know what you need to do, you see the bigger picture that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the command of everything in His hand, and your part is to do your best, and you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you are very transparent and sincere person, and you supplicate and you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, That will bring you the relaxed parenting. The key concept in Islam, and I'm saying this with full responsibility, in Islam, actually, the bottom line is me as a parent, I should be good. If I am a good father, if I am a good mother, and I know what I'm doing, and I have, you know, invested in my relationship with kids, wallahi, you will never fail. You will always succeed. That's why I say, parenting is all about good parents. If parents, they know what they are doing, and they have very clear picture, 99% chance is they will pass. Even if they will fail, down the road, they will see their success. Parents are like role model. Urdu mein kehte hain na, ji maan. Bachchon ki maan, maa-baap hain. Parents are the role model. So please keep this status they have for you in their hearts. We need to invest in this relationship with kids. We should not let them down because they have high expectations. They expect from parents, they will never lie. They will never cheat. They will not go, they will not do anything which is unlawful. Unlawful from the laws of this country or laws by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they have high expectations and high image of parents. So if you will yell in front of your kids, if you use abusive language in front of your kids, if you say things you are not supposed to say, if you fight, you know, with your wife or wife fight with your husband, wallahi, this shakes the whole image kids have about the parents. So I tell you and myself that we are their role model and we have to keep up, you know, this image of us. And kids will do mistake. And as I said, you know, apply this rule. Wife will do mistake. Husband will do mistake. Your extended family, they will do mistake. They will go wrong many, many times. And the ayah I will, inshallah, read to you from Surah Taghabun. Later on, I will go more on this subject. But for right now, just keep in mind, kids will do mistake like we did when we were of their age. We feel like that our kids should be like angel. We were not angel when we were of their age. Now, discipline and instruction. This is very important thing which I want to explain. The difference between discipline and instruction. Instruction is that you have given one command and then you are done. Only you want kids to follow that instruction. Or wife has to follow that instruction. Or husband has to follow that instruction. Discipline is that everybody has to follow that principle. Everybody has to follow that rule. If the rule is after 10 o'clock, there will be no internet in the house. If the rule is that the phone, the gadget of everybody will have no secret password. If the rule is that everybody will use internet or computer in public where everybody can see inside your home, main living room, nobody in their privacy, in their rooms will have access to internet. If this is a rule, then we should be the example for our kids that everybody is following that rule. Even mama is following that rule. Even daddy is following that rule. So that is discipline. And discipline keeps happiness and family together, not just plain instructions. And this is for to change the flavor to my teenager boys and girls. That if you feel like that you cannot introduce your friend to your parents, that means there is something wrong. So you better stay away from those friends. I will say again, if you feel like that you cannot introduce your friends with your parents, that means there is something wrong. So you should be very watchful and careful about those friends. And the second thing, if you are watching a screen, it applies to everybody. It applies to father, mother, brother, sister. If you are watching a screen and thought comes in your mind that if my father will know or if my wife will know that I have watched this, I will feel very bad. That means there is something wrong in watching that screen. Remember one thing, when there is nobody to watch you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. The ayahs, Shaykh has from Surah Hujrat, Shaykh has read, you know, in Isha prayer, wallahi, those ayahs that Allah can see even if it's a dark black night and black mountain and there is a black ant under that mountain. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can see even that ant hiding there. So when you are in front of the screen, always have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He is watching, that nobody can hide. And that was one of the instruction of Hazrat Luqman to his son, that if you want to do sin, go and find a place where Allah cannot see you. If you can find that place, then go and do the sin. You know, our one of the problem which I want to say here is that our problem, it's a universal problem, not America, it's Pakistan, wherever you go. Knowledge by memory. There is no concept now, knowledge with tarbiyah, knowledge with understanding the concept. One time, Sayyid Abul Ala Maududi Rahmatullah Alayh, he went to one university to teach the class. And he said to the class, I am not going to teach you the book. Rather, I am going to teach you the subject. Because book will limit your knowledge and information. But if I give you the concepts, as I said, you know, the concepts, understanding, it will broaden your horizon. It will give you more options. You know, one of the major problems we see as the ummah in our scholars, in our religious people, in our worldly education today, is ilm education just by memory. And because of that, really, we don't see the effect of education. We have more universities, we have more PhDs, we have more doctors, but we have more darkness in this world. If I ask you a question, what you think the world 100 years ago was better or today? I think 100% of you will say the world 100 years ago was better than today. People were more civilized, more loving, more caring. They have, you know, discussion from heart to heart. There was more understanding of each other. And that was because the ilm, the knowledge was not just by memorization, rather by tarbiyah. So this is one of the things which we see in our education system. And unfortunately, the first nursery for children is our home. And our homes are not providing that nursery. The reason is we want to have better standard of life. For better standard of life, you need more money. To have more money, you want husband to work and wife to work. They both have to go out. And I can tell you this, that if you can do three things for your child from very early age, and remember one thing, kids learn maximum when they are in the age they don't know how to learn things. Our brain has two parts, shaur and la shaur, conscious and unconscious. When you are a young child, that is the peak time for you to learn. Without knowing things, unconsciously, whatever you see, it goes in your unconscious brain, becomes part of your personality, becomes part of your behavior, becomes part of you, who you are. Wallahi, that is the most important time of our child, which we feel like that he can go to nanny, he can go to daycare, or we push them to go to pre-K school, or he will learn. No, the best teacher for young child is mother. The best teacher for young child is your home. So that is one thing. The second thing, from very early age, try to put love of books and respect of people in their heart. From very early age, respect for everybody. We should teach them respect we have to respect each other on human level. First, religion comes later on. Wallahi, that is the teaching from the Prophet Muhammad SAW, that love with every human being. Does not matter he is Hindu, he is Christian, he is Jew, whatever faith he has, whatever color he has. Respect for every human being, that should be the first teaching we should teach to our kids. And respect for the books, love for the books. And that is something that we should also do, inshallah. You know, limitation of our education system, I have already said, education system is by memorization. And people who really rely just on the education system, does not matter if it's American education system or, you know, Finland education system, which is the best country for education. Education system has its own limitations. They can only teach so much. So we have to understand that. And as Einstein has said, you know, our education system expects from fish to crawl on a tree. And same way, this education system does not teach our kids exactly and everything they need to live their very good, functional, practical life in this dunya. So we have to understand that. Don't expect that school is going to take care of everything. Now, this is one slide which I want. I love this slide. Actually, you know, in Karachi, we did a very big program. We gathered almost 1,000 parents. And this presentation originally I did for those parents. One of the problem our education system is, and we are very proud of our education system, is to prepare labor, employment mindset. They are very good in, you know, creating and developing employees and employee mentality. Employee mentality is, you know, I call it manager or leader. Manager is somebody that you give him something and you say, now manage these limited resources, limited people I have given you, you manage it. Leader is that whatever resources you give him, he is thinking how I can double and triple and quadruple in so many years and so many months. If you give him human resource of 10, he wants to see that how I can multiply this. And this is not just confined to human resource and money. It's for everything. Leader sees a bigger picture, even from religious perspective. He will not just confine himself, you know, going for salah and reading a little bit of Quran. No, he will think what more I can do to get the closeness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What else I can do so that I will qualify on that day to be with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and shuhada and salihin. So he will always see the bigger picture of everything in life. And that is that our education system is not really equipped with that. So I'm just giving you this understanding, inshallah. Now, these are few prerequisites I have. You know, investing in your child. Most of the parents I have seen, they complain, you know, my child is not listening to me. My child doesn't behave the way I want them to, I expect them to behave. My child is not doing what I want or expect from him to do. The reason is that I ask you that how much really you have invested in your child. I hardly see, yes, there are exceptions to this rule. But if you have invested in your child, invested means quality time, love. You know, I said not sympathy, empathy. Empathy means that you really get involved in everything of their life. You are with them whenever they need you. And I always tell, and people sometimes they laugh, you know, your child does not need BMW or Mercedes or big house. He need you. He need your attention. He need your love. He need your time. So most of the time, you know, and I will share with you later on, that we think that, you know, I'm bringing good food on table. I have given them comfortable house and very good car to ride. You know, I'm a good successful father and I'm good successful mother. Mother is working, father is working. They pick up the child. I feel sorry for those kids when I go after Fajr to my home. And my son was with me other day, so I was showing him, look at this. Early in the morning when all kids are sleeping, this little baby is going to a nanny house or babysitter. You will see the traffic on babysitting houses. So wallahi, we need to invest in our child. Everything you do for your child, from changing diaper to feeding him or taking him for a ride or spending, you know, and exchanging few smiles from very early age, we call in our terminology emotional deposit. Emotional deposit you do in the life of your child. And that pays off as life, you know, moves further. Keeping them in the loop. And this applies to not just kids, husband and wife, extended family. You know, if you have people who are connected to you, keep them in the loop when you are making decisions. Don't give them surprise. Even to young children, if you are going to Houston, tell them ahead of time that tomorrow, beta, we have to go Houston. Not when you have put them in the car, okay, we are heading towards Houston. Don't give last minute surprises. Rather, keep your kids, your family in the loop when it's a consultation time. Because when you talk to them, when you communicate, when you consult, when you keep them in the loop, everybody feels better and good, and they feel like they are basically, they have the value. They feel, you know, encouragement. They feel like they're part of the decision. So that decision will have, you know, more and better effect. And active listening. Most of the time I have seen our kids, they don't need anything but the ear which can listen to them. And I tell parents, you know, active listening is that you really are not just listening. You are not only listening, you are trying to understand and you are participating what your child is saying. Please teach your child politeness, because this is something, it will help them long way in their life. And for that, then I have to be polite and my wife has to be polite. Politeness is something which really is a skill that we can teach to ourselves and our family as well. And how to sacrifice for others. You know, this modernity and modernism, jadidiyat, one of the drawback of this is that everybody has become self-centered. I have to just think about me. Me and my immediate family and not anybody else. So this is something that how to set, even for little children, if they are fighting with each other about something, don't tell your child, I will buy you the same thing tomorrow. No. Teach them how to sacrifice for your child from very young age. This is your turn now. This is turn of your sister. So please, you know, try to teach kids even from their early age how to sacrifice for each other. Importance of relationship, family. This is for extended family. You have to teach your kids that family is important. If they see you, that you care, you take care of your grandparents or your parents, you care about your brothers and sisters, you call them, you get worried about them, you want to make sure they are safe, they are okay, they are happy. If your children will witness that, same thing they will do in their life and they will understand the importance of relationship. So this we have to teach our kids. Self-initiation. You know, we should allow our kids, and I will share this inshallah a little bit more down the road. One of our problem is over-supervision, over-instruction. So that causes a problem which I will talk inshallah later on. Increase their exposure. Exposure from all dimensions. Let them sit with elders. Take them out. You know, kids, they learn no matter what they are doing in their life. When they are playing, they are learning. When they are breaking something, they are learning. Maulana Maududi Rahmatullah Alayh one time asked his friend to bring your child. And he, of course, taking his child to Maulana Maududi Rahmatullah Alayh, so he taught his child, you know, please, we are going to Maulana Maududi. He's a very respectful person. Don't make any noise. Just go and sit down. Say salam. when he came and Maulana Maudi and children were with him, and they sat down after salam. Maulana asked this man, "I asked you to bring your children." He said, "Maulana, these are my children." So Maulana Urdu mein kaha, "Maulana, ye to tumhare buzurg lagte hain mujhe. They don't look like children. They look like your elders. Child is supposed to make little noise. Child is supposed to jump around. Child is supposed to make little noise." You know, and wallahi, as a pediatrician, I can tell you, the kids who make, I'm not saying that we should not discipline them, but this is not a negative for a child. In one of the Turkish mosques, there was a saying that if you don't hear the noise of kids, then be worried about your future generation. Our future generation should be in the masjid, no matter what they do, no matter if they make little noise, because they don't have any other place to go and find refuge. They don't have any place other than masjid to go and learn deen. So please tolerate them. If they make little noise, it's okay. But encourage them to come to masjid, to increase their exposure. My brothers and my sisters, I will just say one thing about this slide. Watch what you appreciate about your child. Because whatever you appreciate, actually that goes in their unconscious brain. And it becomes part of their personality. So don't appreciate everything. Lot of parents, they have this misunderstanding. Let's appreciate everything. And they appreciate out of proportion. So child feel lost. You know, I did something great yesterday. The father was appreciating the same way when I did any little thing. So two things. Watch what you appreciate and appreciate according to whatever proportion, you know, it should be appreciated. So I don't know if, did we understand this point? Understand what you appreciate. So don't appreciate everything. Appreciate what you really feel like that this should be appreciated. Most of the parents, they appreciate, "Oh, you got A plus grade, mashallah." How many of us appreciate if our child does not lie? If he say the truth. He comes to you, he has done a mistake, and he comes to you and accepts his mistake. How many of us we appreciate that? "I appreciate that you have not lied to me. You have told me the truth." How many of us we appreciate the values, the ethics that we should be practicing in our practical life, other than, you know, appreciating their grades? And when you give them any task, lot of parents, what they do, even if they are giving them a hard task, they say, "Beta, it's very easy. It's a piece of cake." Even though it was a very difficult task you are assigning him, what happens, once he does achieve that task, he feels like, you know, it was not that great because it was a piece of cake. It was an easy task. So when you are assigning a task and it's a difficult task, tell your child, "I know, my son, it's a difficult task. It will be a challenge for you, but I know you can do it." So rephrase what you are assigning him. A lot of time the biggest fear parents have, failure of their child. Biggest fear. Every parent has failure of their child. And in this slide, I have written failure prerequisite for success. Calculated risk. People who don't take calculated risk, they can never do big things in life. Yeah, they can be a good employee. They can be a good, you know, servant. They might find a job. They can make them happy to live, you know, a regular life. But if you really want to do big things in life, we should let our child take chances. Take risk, and I call it calculated risk. You know, when eagle is teaching his baby eagle how to fly, what it does? It takes the baby eagle up on the sky and drops him or her from there, from top, and it let it fall up until the baby eagle is about to touch the ground, and then the mother will come and will take over the flight and will save the child. So we should let our kids take risk, take initiative, decide, make decisions. We are there to help them when they need it, but don't do the pampering. Don't do, you know, always just, you know, babysitting for your child. This is our problem. And I have written, this is our three problems, and then I will share with you in the next slide what Quran says. Overprotection, over-instruction, over-supervision. This is a common problem we see in our home. And what happens, it kills their confidence, self-initiation, growth of potential. Over-protection, over-supervision, over-instruction, don't do this, don't do that. If you go there, check this, check that, check this, call me, do this. Let him, give him some room. Give him some space. He will do mistake. He will learn. Wallahi, by mistake, whatever he will learn, you will not be able to teach him in 10 years. What Quran says, and this is the most beautiful slide I have. And this slide teaches you and me the basic principle that how really we can have a happy family. When it comes to the relationship between husband and wife, when it talks about your relationship with your kids, relationship with extended family and community. And I have highlighted, this is the ayah from Surah Taghabun, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, wa in ta'fu wa tasfa'u wa taghfiru fa inna Allah ghafurur rahim. Beautiful. That for family, when you are dealing with family or your kids, your wife or husband, pardon them, forgive them. Sometimes you have to let things go. And then overlook, you don't want to know everything about your home. You don't want to know everything about your child. You don't have to go and look under his bed, what's hiding. So try to give your child some room. Same thing applies when a husband and wife relationship. You don't want to know everything, my brothers and my sisters, to overlook certain things. Your child has respect for you. If he has done some mistake in front of you and he sees that my father might have seen him, so he is trying to feel very bad from inside. You don't have to go and expose him. You don't have to go and confront him. That's why you ignore it. There are many things in life that we can teach a lesson to our child by ignoring it. Not necessary that everything we have to confront. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, cover up. There are certain mistakes that we all do. We want to cover up those mistakes. We don't want to expose. We don't want to let everybody know. If child has done one mistake, we want every brother and sister to know what he has done. If wife has done something, I want everybody in home to know, or husband. Cover up. So these rules, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Because you, as a abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, expect from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do all this for you. What a beautiful ayah. That you expect from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pardon you. You want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to overlook your mistakes. And you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cover up your mistakes. If you expect that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for yourself, then same Allah is commanding you to practice these things when it comes to your family. Subhanallah. This is another thing which I want to say. You know, a lot of time our kid comes to you, Abu, you know, I want to play basketball. And you say, okay, done. You agreed what he said. This is called agreeing. Acknowledgement is not just agreeing. Kids want acknowledgement. Acknowledgement is that he comes, he says, Abu, I want to play football. You will say, yes, beta. What else you need for that? Do you need any dress? You need some practice time? You need me to take you there? You want me to do something for you to, it will become more enjoyable for you? Or you want me to come and watch your game? This is called acknowledgement. We complain, you know, our kids don't talk to us. If you ask them, did you eat? Yes. Do you want to go? No. Yes, no, yes, no. And then parents, they complain. You know, our child, he doesn't talk to us. Give them room. You know, when you are talking to them, get involved. Don't have close conversation. Neither have an open-ended question and answers. So if he comes to you, don't just agree, rather acknowledge. This will open the door for discussion and, you know, interaction, inshallah. And see, agreeing is just simple endorsement. Acknowledging is not only agreeing, but emotionally and mentally getting involved with support and encouragement. These are my last two slides, and I will finish. Never do this to your child, and never do to anybody you have any kind of, you know, relationship or connection. Wife, husband, extended family, do not compare your child with other kids. Very common problem we have in our homes. Look at the child of XYZ. Look at the child of that person. Everybody is unique. 7 billion people in this world. No two are alike. This is the qudra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No two people are same. So don't compare your child from his yesterday. How he was yesterday and where he stands today. So don't compare your child with anybody else. Do not call names. A lot of time I have seen that. You are lazy. You are stingy. You stinks. We label our kids. You know, once you label them, wallahi, their personality shapes, you know, around that. Never challenge their intention. Even if your child is lying in front of you, even if he's lying, you should talk to him in a way, I think, beta, you might have some misunderstanding. I think thing was not like, but don't call him a liar. Do not find excuses for your child's mistake and shortcomings. If child has failed, don't try to find excuses. But I think exam was very difficult. That's why you failed. You know, I think the referee was not fair. That's why you have lost the game. So don't try to find excuses for your child, for his shortcomings and his failure. Because until and unless he will know why he failed, he will never learn. He will never, you know, fulfill that gap. Do not share your problem. Do not be pity. Very common, you know, I have the same problem. We tell to our children, you know, I worked so hard for who? For you. You know, I have given all my life. I have given my, you know, youth for you guys. And you guys still don't appreciate that. Don't share your problem with your child. Don't act pity. Don't show them, you know, the favors you have. You are supposed to do that as a parent. And your parents have done the same for you. And don't share your problem with your children. They don't care about your problem. Wallahi, so a lot of time parents, they share, you know, and this puts them, you know, in a very bad situation. Then they feel like, you know, my father is already so worried and concerned. He has so many things in his plate. If I have a problem, how I will go and share with my problem? So it will increase his anxiety, his problems. So I'll rather keep it to myself. So for keeping this communication with child, don't share your problem. Don't act pity. Yeah, apni mazlumiyat apne bachcho ke samne pesh na karein. Do not remind him of mistakes of his past. This is not just for a child, to husband and wife as well. I have seen in relationship, and there is a hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I will remind all of you, in which he has used very strict words that about a person who reminds you of your past to feel you bad. Wallahi, this is not a Muslim way. If my wife has done a mistake, after 3 years, I remind her, oh, you have done this 3 years ago or 2 years ago. Same thing we do with our child. Oh, you are lazy. You have done the same thing yesterday. You have done the same thing day before yesterday. You always do this. Do not make people feel bad from their past mistakes. Forgive and forget. Forgive and forget. We forgive sometime, but we do not forget. And in the next slide, we always should do, trust your child, respect your child, provide space, exposure to adults. And as I said in the beginning of the presentation, it's not just for child, trust of wife and husband, trust of the extended family, respect. You know, one of the doctors in Pakistan, he was saying, he was using as an example. He said, you know, the people I have seen, and this was in Punjab, I'm not talking about, you know, Karachi or Punjab, but I'm giving you an example. He was just sharing this. He said, you know, I have seen in Karachi, when the parents, they talk to their kids, they respect them so much. Aap ye na karein, aap yahan tashreef rakhiye, aap yahan baithiye. They talk to them in such a respectful way. Wallahi, he said, the doctor was, that I was so impressed. That's the way it should be, that we should respect our children. Because that is the language that you want to teach them. That respect, using polite way, respecting your child. In our cultures, in back home culture, especially, you know, our Indo-Pakistan culture, you know, talking to kids with respect, sometimes some people feel like, you know, I'm belittling myself. Maybe I'm putting myself down. No. As I said from Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala, time has changed. The time and age we live in, this is one of the requirements, is that respecting your child, it helps them to grow his image, his confidence, and his personality. And exposure to adults, our children, when guests come at home, they hide in their room. Mistake, our mistake. We should ask our kids to sit down when somebody is visiting our home, so they should get exposure of adults. In the last, I will say, your hard work will never be wasted. Your hard work will never be wasted. If you have the bigger picture of this deen, that you are taking care of your family and kids, so that you will be successful on that day in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you want your kids to be a better Muslim tomorrow, a better ambassador of Islam, a better representative of Islam, you are teaching your kids the basic morals and values taught by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you are keeping that environment in your home, wallahi, you will never fail. If you will connect your child with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will never lose your child. Even if you will lose your child for some time, he or she is going to come back. The problem is when we connect them to mighty dollar or mighty job or mighty dunya, and when they run away from us and then we complain, then we should have no right to complain. We should have no right to complain, because this was our failure, not their failure. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you me this tawfiq, that we can really understand the purpose of life, the goal set by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he make us successful in this dunya and inshallah in the life hereafter. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allahu Akbar.